about the role of the church in the development of Rwanda. So I tried to spend time understanding what that means. And so hoping that I don't disappoint those who asked me to share about it. My understanding was that what has the church done, what has the church contributed in the transformation of our country, or what can it do? So that's what I try to think about. So let me first confess that I'm not the subject expert on that one, but as a member of what we find out in the church, and as a Rwandan, responsible citizen, I would definitely not fail to find something to share with you. But I wish if we had more time, this would have been better if we discovered it together by discussing about it. Because I was learning by researching about the topic, I learned a lot. I didn't even want to stop. Someone came to stop me, then it's time to go to the banquet. I was still enjoying. I started by freaking out. What am I going to say or do or present? And by the time it was time to come here, I was enjoying this, what I was finding out, relating the church and its contribution in the transformation of our country, and being challenged how much we could do as a church. So that's why I thought, just like many of you, not being subject experts in this matter, we would have discovered this together better by learning and sharing and discussing it. But in the interest of time, I will present you and just say what I found out. And so in your own private time, you could go and expand it and even find out more. So if time allows, I choose to cover this subject in three main areas. One was, I tried to understand, what is the church? What's the church? I didn't want to take it for granted that I know or understand what the church is. So I spent time finding out what's the church. And the other area I wish to cover is, what is the impact of the church in Rwanda? And then, if time allows, we'll look at the characteristics of the features of the transformational or impactful or a relevant church in the nation. But that is subject to time, because I have limited time. So before I proceed, so I would like to bring you greetings from talking of the church. There is a church that meets in my home. That is my family, and the master of ceremony already mentioned about my wife and my four daughters. So they are not here, but wherever I go, I take their greetings. That's a church that meets at my home. I'm the pastor in my home. Church. If you're a man here, should look at that as a responsibility in your home, a pastor and a priest in your home. So the four daughters, Ange, she's 18, Nelly, she's 16, Simi is turning 13, and Shimwa is 8, and my lovely wife, Bonita, they all say greetings and they wish they could be here. For reasons, for technical and spiritual and the other reasons they are not here. So what's the church? By the way, did you receive their greeting?
Yeah.
So do you want me to take your greetings to them?
Yeah.
I don't want to go and say, they returned your greeting when you did not. I don't want to. Because that's what the church is, doesn't like.
Yeah.
So let's begin by attempting to define and understand what the church means, the identity of the church, before we look at now how does the church impact the nation. So I found out that there are mainly two views of what the church is. There is one that's common, that everyone, you know, whenever you talk of the church, people look at, but there's what does God call a church? What is the New Testament church? So the normal, the common definition of the church by most people, just simple, they look at the building where there's Christian religious affairs, you know, the building, the physical building, the cross. That's what they call the church. Others look at an organization or a denomination, Catholic church, Protestant church, Anglican church. But there's also a biblical perspective of the church, biblical point of view. What does God call a church? That's the most interesting part. I enjoyed that part, particularly the New Testament church. Well, I summarized what I found out in a couple of bullets. So it's the body of all believers in Jesus Christ. Okay, and all these are scriptures that go with it. I'll just take you through what all those different scriptures, what you can get from the Bible. Church is the body of all believers in Jesus Christ. Okay? It's members of one body, the body of Christ. The church is the pillar and foundation of the truth. Pillar and foundation of the truth. That's the church. The church is God's family, where we are all sons and daughters of the Lord. I love that so much. We are sons and daughters of the Lord. Okay. The church is God's instrument. The church is one family in multiple places, locations, cultures, in a lot of diversity. Okay, but one family. The church is the visible image or the visible expression of an invisible God. If you're a believer here, you are the church. 2, 3, 4, 5, many of us are the church. We are probably the only thing people will ever see about Jesus. So it's a big responsibility. So I won't go in detail there. We are the hands and feet of Jesus. If Jesus wants to go somewhere and touch someone and do something, guess who that is? It's us. It's not that building. It's not that denomination. It's you and I if we are believers in Jesus. And the church is the salt and light of the world. So think about salt and light, and what the function of salt, the function of light is. Salt for food, for those who don't, who are not restricted by the doctors not to eat salt. But before you stop eating salt, you know why you needed salt. Tasty, and it gets tasty, but it's also, it also preserves. But we also light. Don't go much into those things, because that's not the main purpose I'm here, but just know we are salt and light of the world. We are the body of Christ, the bride of Christ, the people of God, temple of the Holy Spirit. That's the church. I'm sure some of you are discovering that, you know, just like me, it's more than what we think of. We are more than what we consider ourselves to be. And all that comes with responsibility. You can't be all these things and do nothing. The whole body of those who through Christ's death have been savingly reconciled to God and have received new life. That's how I conclude the definition of what a church is. It's the whole body of those who through Christ's death and his resurrection have been savingly reconciled to God and have received new life. All right? And when you think of the church, you could see the oneness I was talking about, but there's diversity in that oneness. And I like how Ephesians 4, 3 to 7 reflects our oneness, but also our diversity and the strength in that diversity. So unity in diversity. It's very powerful. Many times we fight against the diversities among us on the basis of the diversity, yet it's supposed to be a powerful reason for us to unite. Listen to what Ephesians 4, 3, 7 says. Make every effort to keep yourselves united in the Spirit. United in the Spirit. Make every effort. Don't spare any energy to be united in the Spirit. Binding yourselves together with peace. For there is one body and one Spirit. Just as you've been called to one glorious hope for the future. See the emphasis on unity and oneness. There is one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, and Father of all. That's a church who is over all, in all, and living through all. So it's Christ-centered. However, verse 7, he has given each one of us a special gift through the generosity of Christ. See, in that unity, there's diversity. God himself said, however, he has given each one of us a special gift through the generosity of Christ. Instead, we'll speak the truth in love, growing in every way more and more like Christ, with the head of his body, the church. He makes the whole body fit together perfectly. So together in our diversity, we fit together perfectly. There's no accident in tall, I'm short, I'm brown, I'm dark, you know, all these different physical features that people look at and fight and use them to fight against each other rather than enjoy and celebrate God's creativity. You know, God chose to make us, you know, different and give us different gifts. I want to be more like so and so. We start competing and comparing instead of collaborating. So that should be really a motivation for us to start getting closer to each other in all ways, in all possible ways. Because that's what God says, that we fit together perfectly. As each part does its own special work, you don't do someone else's special work, do your own special work. That's what God wants us to do. As each part does its own special work, it helps the other part grow. It's very helpful. So that the whole body is healthy and growing and full of love. I wanted to dwell on what the church is before I go further. So I hope I tried to shed some light on what the church is. You could say a lot because I found out that there are many ways to find a church. But let's move to my second part, which is about the impact of the church in Rwanda. I was going to say, is there any question or comment, but sorry, I'm not allowed to. So as we think of the impact of the church in Rwanda, think of three legs of a stool. A stool standing on three legs. You need all the three legs for it to stand firm. And those three legs, let's look at a nation having, like, standing on three legs. The faith sector, the public sector, and the private sector. The public sector, you know, the government, the legislative, the executive, and the others, you know their function. The private sector, businessmen, Dr. Williams and the others, you know, those were the economic drivers of the nation. We need that. But there's also the faith sector, which is where you find the church, and which is has its unique contribution. So when you think of the impact of the church, think of the church as one of the pillars. But this is a special pillar. This is a powerful pillar. It's a unique pillar. It's playing a unique role. So the church is the center of holistic development of community. because it takes care of the whole person and the whole family for the whole life. None of the other pillars do that. It's only the child that does that. So it takes care of all their physical needs, spiritual needs, emotional needs, mental needs, relational needs, financial needs, all those. That's the church. It does that in contributing to the foundation of the nation. And so if it doesn't do it, it's bad, we'll have failed the nation. When I say church, if you are here and you're a believer in Jesus Christ, know this is your responsibility as far as your country is concerned. We are to do whatever I'm saying here, because that's the command. And as I go into a specific areas the church has contributed, think of the church contribution at three levels. There's primary level, secondary level, and tertiary level. So primary level is just simple, basic, professional skills or needs, you know, that area. And secondary is intermediate or professional skills. And tertiary would be probably advanced professional skills in order to contribute to national transformation. But the part that I like the most is how the church gets unique at the primary level, where these millions and billions of believers around the world can be converted into missionaries. Just imagine getting every member in the community, getting busy, every member of the church, getting busy in the community, being the hands and feet and doing something. Not Sunday, 2 hours are not enough to impact the nation. Sunday, 3 hours, 2 hours of Sunday worship, of service, it's not enough. Most of us like to consider our contribution. Did I go to church? Did I collect offering? Did I sing? That's wonderful, that's good, but that's only 2 hours, 3 hours out of 7 days. Think of the church, where you spend the rest of the week as an ambassador of Christ, as the hands and feet of Jesus. In the government, think of yourself, what are you doing in the government sector, in the public sector, as a believer? Think yourself in the business sector, where you spend the rest of the week, or in the health sector, whichever area you are in, where you spend the rest of the week. Like my church is Christian Life Assembly. So the best way to think of the impact of CLA is to think about CLA Monday, Tuesday, where CLA is, where every member is, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, those in the family, in the relationship to my wife, my children, all that. That's where the church is. That's where the church causes transformation. And it's been happening in Rwanda. And I will tell you specifically how it should be. So in Rwanda, the church has played a foundational role in the development of Rwanda, especially in the post-genocide Rwanda. The Rwandan people needed hope, and this had to be addressed from the grassroots level to the national level. The church has and continues to play a key role of mobilizing the community around the shared vision of national transformation. The church structural setup ensures that you have the largest participation. That's what the church brings on the table. It's very unique, and it's been contributing like that in Rwanda. It's bringing the largest participation because you have so many people in the church. Thousands, millions call themselves believers and go to church every Sunday. It has the widest distribution network. You can go in any part of Rwanda, the most remote part of Rwanda. You may not find a post office, you may not find a road, you may not find a police station, but you'll find two things. A church, guess what the second is? A bar. Go any remote area. By the way, it's true for any community in the world as well. So you find the largest, you know, we'll find us anywhere. So every community, so you can distribute any hope, anything through the church. It's the fastest expansion. It grows so fast. It's always growing. It started with Jesus and 12 disciples. Now we are billions. So it's a movement that grows so fast. It's the strongest authority and simplest administration. Authorized by God, powerful leader. But simplest administration doesn't require a lot of heavy structure. And all that ensures the effectiveness of sharing the message of hope and holistic transformation. Okay? So you can see these two different spheres. With the example, reconciliation, we all know the impact of the church in bringing about repentance, reconciliation, forgiveness, through prison ministry, healing. The church has contributed in those areas of reconciliation in Rwanda in unique ways. I can't go through details, you know, contributing to the church, the courts, you know, mobilizing members to participate. In the health sector is another area that practically the church in Rwanda has contributed in a very unique way. At primary, secondary, tertiary level. There's one good example I can give you at primary level where churches in one community, in Karongi alone, and a few other sectors outside Karongi, where a number over 4,000 members of the church are volunteering and taking care of 7 homes each every week to go just visit, teach them to wash their hands, teach them to, you know, sanitation, hygiene, basic and primary and preventive health care. It's powerful. And now they are saving money because of the diseases they were, you know, suffering, you know, and spending a lot of money when they are preventive. In the area of education, the church has contributed uniquely by, you know, putting vulnerable children to school, sponsoring vulnerable children, you know. Almost 40% of the education institution in Rwanda have been started and supported by the church. So have many, many, many more details. You know, we have universities and others. In the area of family, the church has promoted effectiveness in marriage that leads to the well-being of communities and nations and strengthened the family institution, which is the backbone of the nation. No nation can be stronger than its families are. Never. The stronger the families, the stronger the nation. The state of the family is what you see the state of the nation. So we need to pay attention to this unit, the family. So one day, just get enough time about family and call Dr. Elizabeth again. She'll tell you a lot about it. Maybe she's going to talk about it. I don't even know. There's another special area the church contributed. I don't know if you're familiar with deinstitutionalization. It's very hard to pronounce. I won't repeat it, but you got it.